be all good.
Room number 634931.
for that you can enter a name, not necessarily your name. Okay, it doesn't have to be your name. You can enter any name you want. Any name you want. We already have five, we already have nine people, so we're doing pretty good. Just enter your username, how would you like it? Once that's done, I'm going to ask everybody to answer the question.
If you want to take a few minutes and just answer the first question.
Over the past 10
giving talks on relationships. In this room, in our previous locations, I recently came back from giving a talk on relationships in New York, and I have seen majority of what I'm telling you tonight is from my experience. It's from talking to people who are looking to get into committed relationships. If you're not looking to be in a committed relationship, I'm not going to use the big N word, can I? If you're looking to get married, that's what we're talking about tonight. We're talking about us, our souls, our hearts, our minds that are looking to get married. And it hasn't worked out for us until now. So let's start. Before we get started, what I want you to do is open up to page 3. And you're going to take a few moments. This process is not going to take us more than 20 minutes. Is there a way we can get a copy of this PDF online for people to, It's not going to make it take so long. We're going to try to go through this quickly. The first step is think of what you need, not what you want. Tonight you're going to be making a list. A list of the person you're looking for. I want you to first think about what you need, not what you want. It's important to be specific. If you're vague, this program does not work for you. You need to be very specific. What I did here is I put some things, some ideas that I've taken from other people's lists. These are actual, real ideas from real people's lists. And my hope is these ideas are going to be an impetus for you. But by no means should you use these. They should just get your wheels turning. And if you go to page 4, there is a page here. You don't have to write 44, but write as many as you like. And the question is, what am I looking for in a partner? Think of what you need, not what you want. Be very specific. Take a few minutes to write a number of things. What am I looking for in a partner? Absolutely. There's no time like the present. If you're viewing online, just take a piece of paper out and take a few minutes and write down, what am I looking for in a partner? Think of what you need and not what you want. If anyone's looking at that list of what other people, what I took from other people's lists, how interesting is that? Very interesting, huh? Some other people's, what they're looking for. person who usually likes to take part in these kinds of things, even if you're in a contemplative state, this is a really great time to think about the person that you're looking for, and again, what you need and not what you want. Just a minute left for this part of the program. I know it's very quick, but you have these papers with you, so you'll be able to take them with you and think it over. That's why I put it down on paper for you. You don't have to get it all done tonight. I just want to make sure we can get through the entire exercise tonight. That's the main thing. Okay, even if you're not done yet, we're going to move on because we have a lot to cover tonight. So I want you to go to page 5 now. Go to page 5, and the next question is not what you're looking for, but rather, who am I? What do I bring to the relationship? The reason why I asked you to write first what you're looking for is because it's very, very easy to write what you're looking for, often, or easier to write what you're looking for. It's more difficult to write about yourself. So I'm not expecting you to do it in 4 minutes, but this is the process. After you're done writing what you're looking for, you need to ask yourself a very important question. Who am I? And what do I bring to this relationship? Take 2 minutes and see if you can write a few things down. And you'll be able to do this later at home. You have these papers, or you can download the PDF. You'll be able to do this yourself. I just want to show you the technique and how it works. Now, what I want you to do, after you've done step one, is turn your page to page 6. Take a look at your list. Take a look at them side by side. And what you're going to notice, what you should notice when you do this, is there are similarities on the list. What I want you to do is I want you to make a line across from each similarity. Now, if you have a list of, let's say, 40 things, you're going to find that there's only about maybe 10 or 12, if you're lucky, I would say tops 10, that really have a similarity between one and the other. Now, the problem is I just told that to you, and because probably haven't finished yet. It wasn't a good idea for me to tell that to you. What you should really do is go back home. You should pretend like you never heard Roger say it. And you should make an honest list. Make an honest list too, and then go and take a line and go back and forth. Now, once you do that, you're gonna take a look at the items on your list, and you're gonna see the line going from one to the next. And you're gonna cross off everything else. Everything else is meaningless. I'll tell you why. Because my first secret tonight, you are the complement of the person you're going to marry. You are the complement. You don't want to marry a person who's not your complement. I didn't say your brother or sister. I mean someone who is similar to you. Similarities attract, opposites sometimes attract. But actually, more often, similarities attract. Right? So you want to try to find the similarities between you and the person you want. Shocker right there. I know. How great is that? Look for similarities. Don't look for differences. Differences are nice. Similarities are crucial. Now what you're going to do then is you're going to actually take those items and you're going to put them on this list on page 6. Because you're going to see there's probably somewhere between 5 and 10 or so. And you're going to actually have a great list here of things that you're looking for and things that you're bringing to the relationship. And then what you're going to do is you're going to prioritize that. You're going to put them in order. In order of priority, both lists. And that's going to be page 7. You're going to take that list out of order, and on page 7, you're going to put them in order. 1 is the highest importance, and 10 being the lowest importance. Now we need to begin to talk. Because now we know what you're looking for. So many singles that I meet, so many young adults that I meet, so many people who are looking to meet someone else that I meet, have no idea what they're looking for. I ask them one simple question and they're like, I don't know. Or they'll be dumbfounded. You have to know, which means, if the girl or guy that you are meant to be with is in this room, sorry, I know I put a lot of pressure on you over there. But if the girl or guy you're meant to be with is in this room right now, you have no idea. Because what happens is, we often meet the right one, but we didn't know because we didn't know what we were looking for. You ever walk into a supermarket and say, I'm here to buy stuff? Okay. There's a lot of aisles. There's a lot of things. What are you here to buy? Stuff? Food? Things? Really? What are you here to buy? And I don't, not comparing relationships to a supermarket. I'm just saying that it's terrible. But what I'm saying is that if you don't know what you're looking for, you're not going to find it. You walk over to a person, it's like me in a hardware store, right? I walk into a hardware store and I'm like, I'm looking for the thingamajigger. You know the thing that connects the other thing that makes the other thing go round, round? You know that thing? Yeah, I know exactly. How do you say that in French? If you don't know what you're looking for, you're going to have a very hard time knowing what to do. So let's start tonight's class. Tonight's class is advertised as Jewish Dating Secrets. What are you expecting to hear that you don't know already? I mean, I'm looking around the room. I'd say some of you have been dating for a while, some of you haven't. But you should be professional daters, right? Why is some rabbi who actually just went on a couple of dates, dated religiously, voila, is going to give advice to somebody who is a professional dater? What's the secret? You should know it all. Why did you come here tonight? You think I'm going to tell you something you don't know already? If by chance, and I'm not saying this is going to happen, if by chance you hear something you don't know, let me know. I will be shocked. Because I'm sure everything I'm going to tell you tonight, you already know it. And all you came for is just a reminder. It's nice to get reminded about the things you already know. That's all it is here tonight, a reminder. So, I want to start off by saying, if you came here tonight because you want to feel good about singlehood, is that a word? You want to feel good about singlehood, you came to the wrong place. If you came tonight looking for therapy, not good. If you came tonight, because you're not sure, I'd like that. If you came tonight with this open mind, with this idea that maybe I don't know, that would be the best. So, what I want you to do right now is repeat after me. It's Let's see what everybody said. Wow! Look at that! Look at that! We have a divided room right now. How crazy is that? I mean, not everybody, obviously, is only 19 answers, so not everybody here answered the questions.
Who didn't answer?
Who didn't answer? Many people didn't answer, because there's much more than 18 people in this room, so. Okay. So, if anybody wants to answer, just that doesn't matter. I think we got that idea. Repeat after me. It's all my fault. Say it again. It's all my fault. It's not your grandmother's fault, it's not your hairdresser's fault, and it's definitely not your boss's fault. It's your fault. The end. If you can't take responsibility for all your failed relationships, there's nothing to talk about. If you don't take ownership over your life, nobody's going to. If I'm not going to be for myself, no one's going to be for me, says the Mishnah. If I'm only for myself, who am I, and if not now, when? Right now is our opportunity, because you came here tonight. So if I let you be the same person you walked in, I can do my job. When you walk out of this room tonight, you need to be a different person than the person you walked into this room. If you walk out of this room and say it's not my fault, whatever I'm going to say for the next hour is worthless to you. If you're going to start blaming it on someone else, and there's so many people who could be blamed, but you know what? There's only one person sitting in this room right now. That's you. So blame yourself. Because you are the common denominator in all your failed relationships. It's you. Whatever you've done till now, it hasn't worked. You know how I know? You probably wouldn't be here. So, if we're going to learn anything tonight, just say it's my fault. And say it over and over again. Own it, live it, and be it.
It's my fault.
It's my fault.
I love this. It's
great.
Somebody said that there's actually only one person who answered that question, and they had a split personality, right? Okay, what I'm going to do is, I know a lot of people have questions, What I'd like you to do is write down your questions. I will have time very soon. I'm going to have 3 points throughout the evening where I'm going to take questions. That way we can get through the material and then we can also have time for questions. So please take a minute, write down your questions. I want to hear them. I'm very interested. Now what we're going to do is pick out your phones again, and we are going to ask the second question. The second question. Pick out your phone. If there's more people who haven't done this, if there's someone who needs help setting up their phone for it, Rabbi Josh can walk around and help you set up your phone for this, because I think this is great. What?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. While you can take your answers, here's what I want to tell you. And tired of people who take themselves too seriously. Dating should be an educated, yet pleasurable experience. You have to go out and have fun. There's no question about that. You have to have fun. The person that you're in a relationship or courting or first date or whatever, seeing each other, I don't know all these words that people are using, right? You see each other. I see you, you see me, happy birthday. You have to go out and have fun. But the harder you try, the more you're going to fail. If you try hard to be good at dating, you are going to fail at dating. If you try hard to be good at dating, you will fail. The less you try to impress on a date, the more you will. There's my tweet. The less you try to impress on a date, the more you will. You just have to let go of it yourself. You know what happens? I even see in this room, people just get so anxious and tense up. This could be the one. This could be it. The moment I've all been waiting for. This is it. I've been waiting my whole life for this person. And finally, they walked in. And yes, in 10 years from now, we're going to tell the story about the first time we met. It was so romantic in a coffee shop. Yes, and he ordered the half and half. And I ordered an espresso. And it was beautiful. And we all lived happily ever after. Why do we get so tense? Why do we get so worked up? We put our barriers up. We put our defense mechanisms up. What happens? We become so defensive that it's never going to work out. Because before we came up with it, we started by saying, it's not going to work out. So we thought of every excuse in the book of why it's not going to work out. The fact that we actually got to the date is a flipping miracle, because there was every reason why not to go on the date. I mean, I was going to call him sick, I was going to say that my dog died, or my brother ate my homework. I can't believe how many people I set up. How many couples I set up. And it's all going good, and all of a sudden, the date for now, I start thinking up. Really? You're so interested in meeting someone else, something came up. What could be more important? It's because we create these defense mechanisms. We create these defense mechanisms, and because of that, we end up finding every reason why it's not going to work out. And guess what? It doesn't work out. Shock. We said it. What do you see? I told you it wasn't going to work out. Of course it's not going to work out. If you said it's not going to work out, it's not going to work out. You know, it's interesting. I think that is the main reason why a lot of Jews who are really looking to marry Jews end up falling for people who aren't Jewish. Because I never marry a non-Jew, right? Never, never. My dad had a heart attack, right? Never. My mom, oh, my God, oh, the guy, that was, So every guy who's not Jewish is okay. I'm never going to marry him. We can fall in love. And our defense mechanism is done. But the Jewish guys, we could be the one. This could be it. This could be it. OMG! Hashtag epic! This could be it! Relax. Be yourself. Just be yourself. So what if that's it? Isn't that what you want? Don't be so caught up. Don't take yourself and your relationship too seriously. Don't get caught up in dating. Don't become a serial dater. Doesn't work. If you're looking for a long-term relationship, if you're looking for a serious relationship, don't become a serial dater. Here's something I've observed. People today seem not to believe in themselves. this, I think, causes a lot of confusion. It causes a lot of headache. It causes a lot of difficulty in their search for love. So I was observing something happened in the beginning of tonight's class. And say, I hope you know CPR. Overhearing this, because you take my breath away. Really? Is this what it's all come to? It's the dating game. You gotta play the game, right? You gotta play the game. We're playing the game. The game is, you gotta make cheesy comments like that. They're called, I think, pickup lines. You gotta make cheesy comment pickup lines. And of course, the person you're gonna marry is gonna be, oh my gosh, you wanna hear how we met? We met because some guy, you gotta hear this, okay? He said, do you know first date? That was it. Come on. Really? Is this it? Really? I'm going to tell you a secret. I'm going to tell you a secret. The most attractive quality in the opposite sex is self-confidence. Self-confidence. That's right. It's the most attractive quality. It's achieved when we start to feel good about the direction of our lives. Not because you have a beautiful face, not because you have a big bank account, but because you're simply, you're quietly confident about your ability to contribute something positive to life. That's right. Self-confidence. Now, self-confidence is not fake, because fake self-confidence doesn't work. It has to be real. It has to come from within you. You can't pretend, okay, today I'm going to go on a date, I'm going to be self-confident. This is me. That's me, self-confidence. This is me. I had a couple shots. I'm self-confident. No, that's you beneath me, not self-confidence. Let's go to question three. Everybody take out their phones again. I want to go to question three. The question is, I expect my future partner to contribute to our marriage whatever I contribute. Anything less would be settling. The essential question is, do you want to settle for less or not? That's the question. Do you want to settle for less?
You reset the question.
What? Okay, can you reset the question so people want to reset the question? It's fine. Okay, it was misread. Can we reset it?
No.
Okay, we can't reset it. We can't reset it, it's fine. Changing your answer? Huh? Okay. Let's, before we go to answering this question, I want to take some questions from you. I know you've been waiting to ask some questions, so I'm going to take 4 or 5 questions just for now, and then we're going to split up this evening. Where are we at? Well, okay, we're already telling you what we're pretty late. Who's first? Yes. Very good question. So someone has asked, I opened up by saying it's all my fault, right? But what if you're in an abusive relationship? Is it your fault that you're in an abusive relationship? It's your fault the place you put yourself in. If you chose to leave an abusive relationship, it's not your fault anymore. While you're in it, it's your fault. And if the relationship itself is blocking you from moving on, then it's your fault for not moving on. So wherever you are today, it's your fault. Which means if a person is in an abusive relationship and they leave that relationship, that's healthy. If it's really abusive and they really are supposed to leave and then there's no way to work together. But if it is blocking you today, if you're still in it, even though you left, your head is still there, and that's your fault. So wherever you are today, that's your fault. If you are not happy with where you are today, it's your fault. Absolutely. I was just trying to do that. The same thing is saying it's your choice. Wherever you are, it's your choice. And instead of being passive about that choice, what I'm saying is be active about the choices that you're asking. That's it. I'm going to take three more questions. Not all at once. Yes? Sure. So could it be that God didn't want me to be with someone? I don't know. I don't speak for God. Some people think rabbis speak for God. Rabbis don't speak for God. Did God want you to be? It's very easy to blame God. It's very easy to say God wanted or didn't want. What I'm saying is take ownership, because it's going to help you much more by taking ownership and not taking ownership. That's it. So, yeah, you want to blame it on God. You want to blame it on your mother. I mean, blame it on anybody. But, yes. Yes. What's yours is what you can take care of. If it's out of your control, then it's not yours. You have to make sure that whatever choice you make is a choice that's within your control. And one more question. Okay. I love this. You've been so clear. There's no questions, or you're scared. One or the other. What? I feel like I really removed from you. It's very hard. I'm not like this. I don't like this generally. I want to like sit in a circle, peace, loving, and unity. This class is going to be available on our Facebook page, because once it goes off the live Facebook page, it'll be available. Okay. So, some of you said you didn't answer correctly, but again, we are pretty split as far as this room is really split. It's fascinating. Fascinating. So, my next part of my talk tonight is how do we find the perfect soulmate? Should we focus on what? So here's my secret, okay? Focus not on what you have, but on what you lack. Focus not on what you have, but what you lack. This is one of the biggest mistakes of all. The way people sit down today and think about marriage is they start thinking about everything they have to contribute to the relationship. So a guy says, look, I'm good looking, I'm well educated, I come from a good family, I have a good sense of humor, and I have a great job. So I'm looking for someone who's the same. Bearded black hat, no joke. Otherwise, what am I gonna be? I'm gonna be settling down. Do you wanna settle down? I hear it all the time. You know, Rabbi, I'm finally ready to settle down. What? I'm ready to what? I'm ready to settle down. You're ready to what? What does settling down mean? I know the Bible, it says that Jacob settled down when he pitched his tent and stayed there and rested. What is settling down mean?
I hate that term. I hate settling down.
What's down? What's up? What's right? What's wrong? Today, we have no idea what's right and wrong. We don't. You know why? Because most of what we know about relationships comes from movies. The second most popular genre after horror, I'm not going to talk about that, is romantic comedies. We don't realize that all those romantic comedies that we love to watch, they have affected the way that we treat our relationships. Well, I'm not going to tell you everything about them because I can't go into your mind and tell you everything you know about romantic comedies because I haven't even seen most or any of them. But what I will tell you is that I know that a movie is 2 hours, and that's how long most of our relationships are. It has a beginning, a middle, and an end in 2 hours. And we expect that we're going to get it all in 2 hours. That's all we know. Dating should never begin with what we have. It should begin with what we lack. You don't go into a relationship because you have something. You go into a relationship because you're missing something. And only by identifying that one big thing that you're missing are we guaranteed to find someone who actually makes us feel whole. In other words, although our partner brings many things, most of those things are superficial. They're all superficial. Are we looking for a superficial relationship or not? A soulmate. What is a soulmate? A soulmate brings you only one thing. But it's the most vital thing of all. It's an end to your loneliness and a feeling that you are the most special person in the entire world. It's an end to your loneliness and a feeling that you are the most special person in the entire world. Isn't that all he wants? Isn't that it? Does it all boil down to that and that alone? Why don't we just cut away the garbage and go right to the essence? I'm going to tell you this. My word, my promise to you, when you are ready to get married, we'll meet someone to marry. When you're ready to get married, when you're way ready to cut away the crap, you're going to meet someone to get married. It's that amazing. It's that simple. You think it's complicated. It's not complicated. It's that simple. I want to tell you a couple of modern dating. You're all really successful. I know that. You know how I know? Because you came here. Why would you come here if you're not successful? But I know you're really successful because you're still single. The most successful people are single people. Yeah, that's right. The most successful people are single. Choices, choices. Try to explain what I'm saying. Okay? The more successful we are, the more partners we date, the later we marry. Today, we are convinced that our job is going to provide us with satisfaction because we are really good at what we do. And we hold out for the best. When we feel lonely, we go on a shopping spree. Or we go on some exotic holiday. What do? We distract ourselves when we're lonely. We always talk about how the world is changing. Take a look at the internet. But what we're ignoring today are social changes. This independence is incredible. In almost every way, aside from the way we date. You see, years ago, people looked for one big thing. A lifelong partner. Today, we look for many little things. People who are financially independent have greater choices about their lifestyles. They need to make up this laundry list of the person that would be their equal. Otherwise, they're slowing down. Today, people feel smug about themselves. They rarely look to share their lives. We don't feel any great need to search our own soul for our soulmate. We earn our own money. We own our own cars. We have our own circle of friends. We live on our own. At least some of us do. After 40. To look for a soulmate would indicate a deep-seated inadequacy that we're not prepared to conceive. So instead, what do? We look for a partner. So now what do I want to do? So I want you to take a look at your list. The list that you made in the beginning of tonight's class. And I want you to ask yourself a very important question. Am I looking for a partner or a soulmate? What's the difference? A partner is someone who is going to share my life. It's a tit for tat. I'm cool, you're cool. I'm nice, you're nice. A soulmate is one big thing. Does that person bring an end to my loneliness? Soulmate is one big thing. Does the person bring an end to my loneliness and make me feel like I'm the greatest thing that ever existed? That's it. That's all it is that whole list, everything that you wrote or everything you're going to write, is meaningless. If that person is not going to bring an end to your loneliness and make you feel like a $1 million. That's it. They can be nice, wonderful, beautiful, rich, famous. Doesn't matter. It absolutely doesn't matter. You know how we date today? We date today because we're obsessed with the royals. Aren't we obsessed with the royals? The royal family, right? Not the baseball team. No, we're obsessed with the queens, the princess, and the celebrities. How do royal families for centuries marry? Well, I have this kingdom, so my son comes from this kingdom, and your daughter comes from this kingdom, and we're going to bring the kingdoms together. That's what we're looking for. I know that we're so obsessed with the royals that we can't get our head or our heart out of them. But what are we really looking for? Is this a royal relationship? No, it's not a royal relationship. It's a real relationship. We're looking for a real relationship. Then we have to know what we're looking for. Aristocrats. From the beginning of time, this is how they thought. They thought that they could truly never be happy in love. The best they could hope for is a harmonious relationship. Those who wish to find their soulmates, that's us. That's a different breed. We're not looking for a partnership. We're not looking for a business. We're not looking to get into business with someone. Oh, you have 50% and I have 50%. Okay, let's do that. We'll share our apartments. We'll share our living quarters, we'll share the food, we'll share the dog, everything will be good. We're not looking for a partnership. We are looking for a real relationship. We're looking for the person we lost at the beginning of our lives. When our souls came into this world, there was someone who was disconnected from us. They were part of us, we were one. We have now been searching 20 or 30 or 40 or whatever years for that person that we lost. We're trying to find them. We know who they are. We know them. because we once had them, and now we're trying to find them. We're not trying the right way because we're making all these lists of things that are meaningless. Right? Getting a lot of etchings. I don't know what to do with all this etching. There's one thing that we need to get into a relationship. There's one secret. I'm going to give it to you right now. It's the only thing that I want you to take out of tonight. Everything else is great. The only thing you need to get into a long-lasting, healthy, and successful relationship. I'm not saying to maintain it. Maintaining it is a different conversation. But the only thing you need to get into a long-lasting, healthy, and successful relationship is humility. That's it. Be humble. That's all you need. You need to not be afraid to say to that woman that you're in love with her. Can't live without her. You can't be afraid. I was lecturing at a Chabad home in New York, and after I finished, a woman came over to me and starts telling me that she has a whole list of what she's looking for, and she's going on and on this list. And I'm listening to this whole list of what she's telling me. And she says afterwards that there's a guy who's been asking her to go to the next level. I don't know what that means. They want to take the relationship to the next level. And she keeps on saying no. So what kind of guy is he? He sounds exactly what you're looking for. So she takes a step back. She's like, hold on a second. You mean he's the one? I say, yes. He's the one. My heart is pounding right now. He's the one? Yes. Why is that so scary? Isn't that why you're looking? I don't understand. Isn't that what you came here for? Isn't that what you're looking for? He's right there in front of you. What? What's going on? She's like shuddering and shaking. I don't know what to do with myself. I mean, he's the one. I said, look. I don't want you to talk to me again until you talk to me and say yes. No, I can't do that. No, I can't do that. Why? It's a world of equality. Equal rights? Come on! It goes both ways. You gotta say yes or don't talk to me again. So this is Chabad. I knew she wasn't going to call. Not my business, but she probably wasn't going to call on Chabad. So she comes over to me after Chabad and she starts talking. I said, wait! Did you call him yet? No. I said, sorry, my mom to you. So she comes over to me Sunday morning, the end of this weekend, and she says, okay, I called him. And I said, yes. And I said, now what? So relieved. It's not so scary. I tell you, before I got married, I started getting folks think it's normal. Folks be, started thinking, oh my gosh, it's life, blah, blah, blah. So I went to my mother and I said to her, I don't know, maybe we should hold it off. Maybe we should like push off the wedding or something. And like, I have to really rethink this. She looks at me with a stern look and says, stupider people than you have done this. That's my mom, yeah. Stupider people than you have done this. Different conversation. I want to tell you, it's not so scary. The secret is be yourself, be humble. And look for the person who's going to make your life better. Who, after a long day of work, when your boss got to you, somebody else got to you, and the world is going down, you always know you can go home. There's someone there who forever thinks you're limitless. That's all you're looking for. That's what long-term love looks like. There's a lot of other elements to it, but that's what's the most important part. Get rid of all of the extraneous noise that's bothering you, that's stopping you, that's blocking you. If you need to go for therapy, go for therapy. If you need to go talk it out with someone, talk it out with someone. Don't make a survey out of it. Don't talk it out with the world. Don't just talk to everybody who you see on the bus. But even talk it out, talk it out. If you have something that's blocking you from getting into a serious relationship, deal with it. But there should be absolutely nothing that's stopping you. Stupider people than you have done it. That's it. That's all I have to say. That's the end of my chapter tonight. L'chaim. I'm going to take some questions now. If you want, you can please answer the feedback question. So while you're asking the feedback question, I'm going to pick some questions from you. And it's too far back over there, you know what? What's happening? What's going on? Okay. So? That's Jason and Carol right there. They're getting married soon. I brought them here tonight to show you it's possible. No, I'm joking. Jason, I had to be here tonight because I've been giving these relationship talks for almost 10 years now. Since 2006, right? So 10 years now, I've been giving these relationship talks. And Jason has come for just about everyone. We talk about 7 game halves, our winning. It's a class full of girls and Jason. Because he didn't miss it, because I told him if he goes to wash the hats, then they're going to lose. So he came to my relationship talk. Jason says it's not going to take 10 years for everyone. What? They always won when he came to my talks. Yes, he was. The reason why the Habs win is because of Jason. But we'll talk about that at a different time. What else? That's it? No questions? Yes.
You gotta go seek help and
make it work. Because marriage, you want marriage to last. And make sure you have so many good things. But if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. And yeah, yes. I understand. So there's a question over here? Yes.
Okay.
When people show you who they are, believe them the first time. I love that. It's great. Yes. Yes.
I don't know what that is.
When people show you who they are, usually first impressions
are
what they are. But not, I mean, look, a lot of people on dates, I've heard, I think my parents speak to a lot of relationships. I see it all. I think I've seen, I don't, there's nothing lately that's come past my desk and I'm like, oh, that's a shocker. I see it all. And people often tense up in the beginning. It's just the reality. It's human nature. We were not ourselves. What you want to be is you want to be yourself. That would be ideal, but often people tense up. You can't think about that. So, yeah, it's a great statement, but sometimes you have to be careful because... I understand. If you're seeing signs before the marriage, be careful. Absolutely.
But isn't that the same thing?
Now, but often, what I'll add to that is often, the way we date, you know, living together and all that stuff, it's really positive because it creates a situation where it's very hard to get into a serious relationship or a long-term relationship. And I know some people asked me earlier, I would talk about the whole dating, what was the question? In a Tinder world, how do you get into a serious relationship? I'm going to talk about that in the future. It's a great topic, and I think it's really important. And if you have other topics you want to talk about, please send them my way, because I think that what I see after tonight is that this is important, and I want to start talking about this, and I want to help you out. So let's continue this. Yes. So what happens when one person feels very, very strongly towards another and another person doesn't? I want to tell you something, a secret that I know only from being a matchmaker. Often when someone's crazy about someone else, the other one is not. It's just the way it works.
What? What's it? Maybe.
Yeah, sure.
That's what I think also works. Chemistry is very important in a relationship. If you don't have that,
physical attraction is important. I'm not disagreeing with physical attraction. What's important is that don't be over-eager. Don't be, you know, sometimes if you really like the date, what happens? A lot of guys come back, oh my gosh, I love the date. You know why? I'll tell you why. Because they spoke the whole time about themselves. She didn't say a word, and they felt really good that she was the therapist. So they felt really good at, oh, this is amazing. And she's like, I don't want this. So a lot of guys have a problem with speaking too much about themselves. So what did I say? Humility. Part of humility is don't speak too much about yourself, especially on the first date. You know, give us a space. So what we're talking about. talk about is this Facebook generation. Today, people are more comfortable texting and Facebook messaging than they are actually speaking face to face. It's very hard. Facebook, not Facebook, right? So you want me to go back to the question from before about somebody, there's one person who really likes a person that, okay, so there are some people, like, let's go back to high school, there's some people who are popular. You know what makes people popular? Heightened levels of electromagnetic energy. Correct, doctor? There are some people who extrude electromagnetic energy at higher levels than others, and they become, what's the word? Not popular, what's the word? Attractive. They're attractive. They attract people to them. And so, let's get out of that. Let's do that for a second. There are some people who become popular, or they don't realize what they're doing, but they become over-obsessive in their dating. And because they become over-obsessive, it's really one-sided. They use their dates as a one-sided thing. They're really just looking at themselves. They're really not interested. Marriage doesn't make sense. Relationships don't make sense. In order for a relationship to work, for a relationship to make sense, you need to give up yourself. You can't put a barrier in front of yourself. You can't say nothing about yourself. You can't get not personal because you're afraid that you're going to get let down. You have to be vulnerable. I know it's hard because you may get let down, but you may not get let down. You have to be vulnerable. And you know what happens over time is we date and we go out and we see and we're seeing and seeing. I don't know how much we're seeing today. And as a result, we put up so much of a fence between us and the person that we're meeting that it's impossible for anything to get past it because we're afraid of getting hurt. And because we're afraid of getting hurt, we are hurting ourselves. We're afraid of getting hurt, and so we're hurting ourselves. Don't be afraid. Become a little vulnerable. I'm not saying a lot vulnerable. Don't go to extremes. Just a little vulnerability. Open up a little bit. And as the relationship progresses, you can open up a little more, and a little more, and a little more. If you're constantly going to stay closed, and you're not going to open, you're not going to get anywhere in your relationship. Look, I can stand here and I can talk all night. Is there one last question?
Okay.
It's yours.
I'm going to challenge.
Okay. I'm getting a challenge. A question. Question. No statements.
Okay. The person made a comment that Dr. Anderson said that the person that you see is the real thing. Because in different situations that I've seen many people here, at different times, I could be wrong, they're actually the same piece. First of all, our perspective of them is very different.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Look, it's very important. I think that we all interface differently with different people. And I think that it's important that we understand that we're not always showing the same side of ourselves. No, if we were the quintessential person of who we wanted to be, then we would always show the right side of ourselves. But because we're not, we're human beings and we have flaws, that's okay. Nobody said be perfect. Just be better. We're doing something better today than we did yesterday, and we're doing the right thing. So because we're not the quintessential person, and because we're not that ideal person, then we have to know that not always is that first impression the right impression. You know, sometimes you feel bad after giving the wrong impression. I often say to people, after they've gone on the first date and said, no way, I said, give it a second try. Always give it a second try. Because you're going to see a different side of the person. You won't see the same person. The first date is the hardest. It's very hard to make a decision about a person when you see them for an hour or two or three, no matter what it is. And especially in today's generation where we have such a flawed perspective on what relationships look like and what dating looks like. Thank you very much. It's been a lot of fun. I hope we can do this again. Please send your ideas. We want to hear your ideas. What we I'm going to announce it for the first time right now. July 8th is a First Fridays. We're not doing July 1st because we know July 1st is a tough weekend for a lot of people. Being away. We're having our first Fridays here on July 8th. And also, anyone who'd like to help us out, we have 3 weeks left to our annual raffle, and it helps us keep doing all the money for work. Two beer and $50 a ticket. And the raffle, you can take Jason to take care of the door if you want, or anybody else take care of. There's a bunch of people here who are selling tickets. Dan, Jason, Mitch, anyone else who are selling tickets, please help us out. Help us out. It's great. And anybody who is interested in my coaching or matchmaking, I just opened up a brand new part of J Montreal. J Montreal is my dating site. And I've opened up a new part of it, which is now a platinum membership, which includes coaching. I help you work on yourself, prepare yourself, and then I also help you search. It's much more personalized. Now, obviously, there's a fee attached to it, but I've seen a lot more results from this. So take a look at jmontreal.com. You'll see all the information over there. I only have about 8 slots open right now for the coaching. So that's the story.
Paranoid to move?
Why?
With all these cameras on?
No, it's going live. Okay.